please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
N. Chandrasekaran, now he completes 1 year as Tata Sons chairman, keeps to his promise of stabilizing the conglomerate by simplifying the structure. Prashant Nair is here with a detailed analysis of Chandra's first year at the helm of Tata Sons.
Eventful year under N. Chandra, completing 1 year at Tata Sons. Let's look at the fixes. Companies which needed immediate attention and which have got attention. Tata Teleservices is one, the telecom business. We got that resolution of $1.2 billion with NTT DoCoMo. Subsequently, the mobile business or the company was sold to Bharti. Relieved a lot of stress, financial stress. Tata Steel merged the European business with Thyssen Krupp. The process began before him, but he completed it. Now, of course, Tata Steel is eyeing stressed assets. Tata Motors, the long-suffering CV business, has started to turn around because of a lot of initiatives. And at Tata Communications, the approval to sell land parcels has come through. Chandra has also brought about a lot of new faces, not just at the group level, but company level, at Tata company levels as well. So Saurabh Agarwal, the group CFO, Banmali Agarwala, GE veteran now heading the infrastructure cluster, Shuva Mandal, group general counsel at the group, and appointees at Indian Hotels, Tata Capital, Tata Motors, etc. Tata group watchers say the biggest impact has been the stabilization of brand equity for the Tata group itself. It took a battering because of the fighting we saw, very public sparring we saw, before N. Chandra came in into the chairman's role. Simplified group holding structure, we've seen buybacks, etc., much appreciated. Clear articulation of plans for the company, which I think was missing before, is now there. And believe that shareholders will be a top priority for the management running the group. I think that's an important one. So to take off from that point about shareholders, how have markets seen all this? Well, in a very favorable light generally. Look at the top performing stocks over the last 1 year in the Tata Group. Tata Global, Tata Titan, Voltas, you would say these are all consumer facing businesses. Well, that's true. But Tata Steel has done pretty well as well. It's up about 41%. Look at Tata Chemicals, 22%. TCS up 20%. And then there are laggards as well. Tata Motors is still down 19% from the last year's level. Tata Communication and Rallies are other stocks which are lower. Back to you.
Okay, and you can catch that special coverage on N. Chandrasekaran completing a year as Tata Sons chairman all through the day right here on CNBC TV18. Well, the National Pharma Pricing Authority has analyzed bills from four hospitals in the National Capital Region and has put out a long report claiming that hospitals indulge in unethical profiteering and profit margins on certain drugs and medical devices were exorbitant. Ekta Batra joins us with some details now. Ekta, over to you.
Well, yes, an important and long report, which in fact came out from the NPPA, where they've analyzed four bills from hospitals in the Delhi NCR region on the basic premise of overcharging. The names of the hospitals and the cases, however, have not been disclosed. So what the regulators, for example, have found is that doctors' hospitals prefer to prescribe branded drugs which are not under price control. The drugs which are not under price control, in fact, have been growing at a double the rate that than those drugs which are, in fact, under price control by the NPPA at this point in time. Separately, there have been exorbitant profit margins as well as unethical profiteering, which has been charged when it comes to basic things such as syringes as well as catheters by the hospital to the patients. And overall, the patient's expenditure was inflated by around 3 to 4 times in cases, and patients were not given a choice to procure drugs and devices outside the hospitals. The hospitals, in fact, benefited the most, according to the NPPA, vis-a-vis drugs as well as device manufacturers. Overall, they have mentioned that policy intervention is required to address high growth in drugs which are not under price control, as well as requests from some manufacturers in terms of devices have come through for rationalizing the margins that we've seen.
All right, thank you for that, Ekta. The NPA problem wasn't enough. Now we have NPPA. But talking about exorbitant pricing in private hospitals, that's indeed a serious issue.
Well, let's shift focus to the world of commodities now. And Manisha Gupta joins us early this morning with all the update from the commodity space. Manisha, good morning. Tell us, what is the headlines from the world of commodities today?
Plenty, really, as always. But, you know, it is really about the gold prices, which declined nearly 2% yesterday. It is the biggest one-day decline that the gold prices have seen since December 2016. And the decline has come on the back that you have seen the money going back in equities, The US dollar has continued to strengthen. That one is trading at a one-week high. And the markets also are watching out for the physical buying, which actually is quite absent. So that really has pulled the gold prices down. Apart from that, also, if you look at the US Treasury yields, those are at four-year highs. That's yet another reason that you have seen this sell-off come in case of gold prices. Not just precious metals, but the industrial metals also have been under pressure in the last 24 hours. We will actually see more participation come back as China returns from its one-week Lunar New Year holidays tomorrow. So tomorrow is going to be a day of volatility. Today, of course, we are looking at further profit-taking continuing. Another hike, though, we have is what has come in case of the crude oil prices, where you have the U.S. crude trading at a two-week high. Markets are looking at decline in U.S. inventories. The OPEC commitment to continue beyond 2018 has been positive as well. And it is only the strength in U.S. dollar which is capping a rally in case of crude oil prices. But apart from that, this is the second straight week, which we perhaps will close in the positive when it comes to energy as a sector.
All right, Manisha, thanks a lot for that. Let's shift focus back to the equity markets, the futures and options space one day ahead of expiry. The key point is FII selling like it is the end of season sale. Because if you take a look at it, cash market, 850 crore worth selling, index futures, 1800 crore worth selling, and index options close to 1500 crores worth selling. So in index futures, what the FIIs did were they added almost about 3000 longs and 24,000 shorts. So with that, the FII long exposure in index futures has dropped to 41%, the lowest in this series, the lowest in a lot of series since I've seen over the last at least 1 year. This is the lowest that the FII long exposure has been. The Feb to March rollovers have been lower as well. So that is something we'll be watching out for, because if there is a lot of open interest pending to be rolled over, that could add further pressure. The Feb futures has turned into a 17-point discount versus a bit of a premium. So that would tell you the ferocity of selling. But if you take a look at the index options out there too, the sell figure was selling in index calls. The FIIs have sold index calls, but the 10,300 put, that one has maximum open interest ahead of expiry. So is there support at the lower end? And if there is support at the lower end, and as the SGX Nifty indicates, we're moving higher, then there is case for some short covering as well, because both the 10,400 and the 10,350 calls saw a bit of writing premium anywhere close to 30 to 50 rupees out there. In terms of stocks, watch out for IFCI, that one enters FNO ban. Also watch out for HDIL and Orient Bank, both of them are out of FNO ban. Talking about HDIL, keep an eye out on the fact that yesterday we got a circular from the NSE which said HDIL will be excluded from FNO trading from April 27th, which is the start of the May series.
Okay, so a bit of case for short covering today as well. But on to the bullseye corner now. Our contestants this week, Richard Jain, Rakesh Bansal and Vishal Malkan, are battling it out for the strongest portfolio. Let's hear their picks for the day three of the week.
My first call today is a buy call in ABB. It's stop loss below 1470 for a target of 1570. My second call is a buy call in Godrej Consumer. It's stop loss below 1039 for a target of 1091. My third pick is a buy call in Titan. It's stop loss below 815 for a target of 861. And my last call is a sell call in IRB Infra. It's stop loss about 227 for a target of 212.
My first call is a buy call on Ashapura Intimate Fashion Limited. Buy Ashapura Intimate Fashion, stop loss 456, target 504. My second call is a buy call on Indigo. Buy Indigo, stop loss 1249, target 1330. My third call is a buy call on Excite. Buy Excite, stop loss 206.80, target 218. My last call is a buy call on Coal India. This is an index stock, this is my power play. Buy Coal India, stop loss 299.80, target 321.
Jain Irrigation, buy with a stop of 115 for targets of 128. Polaris, buy with a stop of 455 for targets of 520. KTK Bank, buy with a stop of 128 for targets of 145. And Hexaware, buy with a stop of 328 for targets of 360.
All right, those were the picks of our Bullseye contestants. With that, there's a curtains down on Power Breakfast. Stay tuned to CNBC TV18. Bazaar Morning Call comes up next.